Hey guys, it's Danny. Today we're gonna talk about planting orchids together in the same pot, pretty much community potting. Many of you along the years asked me about this and I did touch base in a few videos, but I think a proper separate video with all of the details that I can give you is in order. Particularly because I just have to scrap one of my projects I was working on in the background. Apart from the projects that I film and I offer you updates on, I do have a few that are long term, which I do in the background. I have footage and I will publish them in a year or even two. This was one of them. These are two mini phalaenopsis, which look identical. They were purchased separately from the very same flower shop, so they could be seedlings in the sense that they come from the very same seed batch, or they can also be clones. I'm not entirely sure, but they are of the same age, they have the very same flowers, and I wanted to experiment with one being fertilized and one not being fertilized. And I've been running the experiment for 3 months now, and I realized this bark that I'm using, it's the older one I find locally, is fertilized. So yeah, I cannot carry on with the project. But I can definitely exemplify a community pot, talk more about it. So first let's go through the most common instances in which one might find orchids potted together. First of all, an orchid and its keiki. In some cases, the keiki can still be attached, like in the case of monopodial orchids, and I have here a phalaenopsis. I purchased this orchid like this, and the keiki is still attached to the plant, but it has its own root system, its own leaves, and definitely it can bloom on its own. Next year, most probably this year, I already had this orchid in bloom. So in this case, obviously, there's no reason why we cannot keep both of these orchids together, since both of them have their own root system and are perfectly capable of sustaining themselves. There are rare cases in which the keiki can deplete of energy the mother plant, but they're extreme and usually imply that the mother plant doesn't have a good root system while the keiki doesn't have any roots at all. Other than that, I think you'll find this particular setup quite popular. And then there are instances in which keikis are completely detached from the mother plant but potted together. This is very common with sympodial orchids, and I have an example here. This is an epidendrum which produced a keiki on its flower spike, but the mother plant is actually down there. I can easily remove that keiki and pot it together with the mother plant, and in this way I can actually get a bushier plant with multiple canes which will bloom. This is one of the main reasons why some orchid growers keep the keikis and pot them together with the mother plants, but it is more frequent with cane-like orchids than with phalaenopsis or other more broad orchids. Another very common so-called community pot is one in which two identical orchids are potted together, but one is not actually the keiki of the other one. In many cases, it is actually a sibling, if you want to call it like that, because in many, many cases, orchids will clump up together when they start to grow, when they sprout, and people just put them together in one pot. They will mature next to each other, and even though they're not actually connected, there is a high chance they are actually relatives, or if they're not, they're of the same species or genus. However, potting two orchids that look identical in the same pot doesn't need to happen at a seedling stage or a seed stage. There are people who actually do buy two of the very same orchids and just pot them together just to get more flowers or more leaves, depending what you're looking for. In many cases, people use sympodials for this because they can create a lovely clump, a lovely bush. But monopodials can be potted together as well. Look-wise though, they really don't look like they are one plant. In this case, you can see there are two different plants potted together. I think these are actually related because I did receive them together and I decided to maintain them together in the same pot. And another instance, which is actually very, very uncommon, is potting a kind of orchid with a different type of orchid. So let's say a phalaenopsis with an oncidium, or an epidendrum with an angraecum, a genus of orchid with a different genus or a different type of hybrid. Usually orchid growers don't do this because, amongst other things, two different genera of orchids might have very, very different requirements, and potting them together might lead to a conflict of interests, if you want to call it like that, in the sense that one set of roots would like to be more airy and the other set may be more moist. One of the orchids might produce a lot of roots, very wild and very robust, while the other orchid might produce very flimsy, very sensitive roots, so there will be some competitiveness when it comes to space, water, and nutrients. And now that we mentioned the different community pots you can think about doing, let's talk about some pros and cons. One main bonus is that if all orchids start to produce flower spikes, the show would be a lot more impressive in one single pot. This applies to all orchids we want to plant together, of course. While in some cases, not only the flower aspect is desired, but the entirety of the plant. Let's imagine that this orchid is actually two orchids potted together, and each orchid is actually half of the plant that I have. You can actually see that overall I have a bushier and more luscious effect. The more leaves, the more pseudobulbs, the better. But of course, this applies to certain orchids, not necessarily all of them. In my opinion, phalaenopsis don't really look all that great if you pot multiple ones in the same pot, but that's a personal preference. Second of all, conserving space. Two pots generally take more space than one pot if their sizes are similar in between them. So if we have two of the same orchid, why don't we plant them into a slightly larger pot, which will take less space on the shelf, giving us the opportunity to actually put different types of orchids without actually sacrificing the size of the orchid or the blooms or the foliage or the aesthetical appearance. And third of all, management. It is easier to manage one single pot when it comes to fertilizing and watering than two pots. And thinking about this on a bigger scale, when we have a bigger collection, it is pretty obvious that we do prefer more compact orchids, more concentrated orchids that are easier to maintain and put on the same show as two separate orchids would. But here are some major cons to consider. First of all, when putting together two strange orchids, there is always the chance that they will pass disease and pest to each other. It's one thing to receive two seedlings coming from the same batch together, and another to take two separately potted orchids and combine them. Even if they look the same, if they don't come from the same place and they haven't been treated the same, then there is a chance they will pass disease to each other. And things can be quite dramatic because some of them can harbor disease which is invisible, at least at the beginning, such as virus, which can sometimes only show when the orchid is stressed. Also, the carrier orchid can be resistant to a particular pathogen it's carrying, but the other orchid might not be. So again, even if they look the same, it doesn't mean they will act the same because they are two distinct individuals, which have been grown in very different conditions in different places. Then, in some cases, we can talk about allelopathy. I don't think it has been proven yet with orchids or studied for that matter, but it is a well-known fact that certain plants will act against other plants in order to maintain their territory and protect their resources. And even if we're not sure if orchids do this, I cannot say I have observed this behavior, but I didn't really pot too many orchids together. I have phalaenopsis and a few other very common orchids potted together, but I cannot generalize this to all orchids because there are way too many species and hybrids out there, and I really don't know how they will interact with each other when placed in the same pot. Then there is a chance they are incompatible, particularly if we are trying to put together two different orchids which come from different genera. As I was saying, some might have very different requirements when it comes to watering, the medium itself, light quantity, humidity, temperature, and so on and so forth. And not only that, growth-wise, they might not be compatible. Some orchids take a winter dormancy or a winter rest. They have distinct growing periods, while others might be continuous growers. Some orchids might be big root producers, others might not be. Therefore, the orchid with the most root advantage will pretty much benefit from all of the moisture and nutrients, while the other orchid might not get enough to flourish. This incompatibility can actually extend to two of the very same orchids. If one orchid just turned out to be a little bit more sensitive, less robust than the other one, especially in the case of seedlings, then it will grow a little slower. It will have a disadvantage, so one might develop and flourish and the other one might be overshadowed by the other and depleted of nutrients. Case in which our whole arrangement and hope for more flowers and bushier looks will just go down the drain. These things are rather theoretical. Just because the risk is there doesn't mean that something bad will happen, but in some cases it does happen. There are ways in which we can minimize the risk, of course. Quarantining, observing orchids, just potting orchids which we know are seedlings, a keiki and a mother plant, or two seedlings coming from the same batch, those are very low risk, let's say, individuals to work with. However, I would advise you that if you have an orchid which is very precious to you, I would not pot it together with anything else. I would just keep it in its own pot, just because the risk is always there, and losing that orchid, I'm sure, will cause a lot of sadness to any of us. So that's pretty much the story with all of us growers. That's pretty much why all of our orchids are potted separately, because, well, most of them, if not all of them, are really precious to us and we're connected to them and we don't want to risk much with them. There are sometimes cases in which the risk is not all that high. So since I do have two available orchids that come from the very same place and look identical, I'm not sure if they come from the same seeds or from the same clone, but we're as close as we can get. Let's see how we go about potting two Phalaenopsis orchids in the same pot. First of all, we need to think about a pot which can accommodate two orchids. Phalaenopsis orchids will not stop producing roots. If they are too tight or run out of space, they will still produce roots and they will find a way to put those roots somewhere. Outside of the pot, through the drainage hole, aerial roots, nothing can stop them from producing roots, except rot, but that's a different story. So we need to take that into consideration, and even if the orchid will find ways to put its roots somewhere, we want the vast majority of roots to be in the pot, because this is where the moisture is. If everything is aerial, or most of the roots are aerial, we will need to supplement with water. Now in my example, I'm not going with a very, very large pot. It is definitely larger than the one they're potted in, simply because I want to test out another type of medium, but that's besides the point. Choose a pot that can sustain two orchids, as well as use the medium you like best, but make sure it's fresh. Don't use one of the mediums or both of the media these orchids come with, because there is a chance that one has some pests inside the medium. And we don't want the new community pot to be contaminated. Just think of it as a normal repotting. Don't reuse the old medium. If you don't know where it's coming from, if you don't know if it has pests and so on and so forth, it might be old, it might be decomposing. Tons and tons of reasons why you should use fresh medium, which can be whatever medium you like best. Follow your normal repotting regime, cut away all of the dead roots, and try to clean up the root system as best as possible, being that these orchids were already sprayed with hydrogen peroxide when I purchased them, and I know the past medium was okay. I'm not going overboard with cleaning the root system, as you can see. Furthermore, I shall be using partly organic medium this time as part of the experiment, but do go through your usual repotting routine and clean up the root system as much as you want. And then before potting them, it is a good idea to see how are we going to arrange these orchids. Since they are Phalaenopsis orchids, arranging them needs to make sense. We don't want one shading the other like this, so we need to put them next to each other on the same plane, let's say. So maybe something like this will look nice and will be okay with both of the orchids. It's really hard to hold both of these orchids, to be fully honest, specifically because I have root tips and I already broke a root tip, but it's okay, we have a lot of roots. So yeah, it's much easier to work with one orchid. And now, just like with other repottings, we need to place the medium inside the pot. Today, I shall be using sphagnum moss together with LECA. I want to do this combination because I always say that I don't like to mix LECA with sphagnum moss because of the organic component. But this sphagnum moss that I'm using is quite a good quality sphagnum moss. Also, I want to see how fast it decomposes when it's trapped in between the LECA spaces. And when it does decompose, can we actually flush it out easily from between the LECA like we do with all of the root debris in semi-hydro and so on and so forth? So that's what I'm curious to see. I want to assess how badly the moss decomposes, how fast, and when we combine it with LECA, how would a repotting be? So I'm using LECA because it is inorganic, it shall not decompose. It's also a very good filler. I have tons of LECA and I don't want to use all that much moss. I want to be more economical, so I really do want to test out this combination. This is hard. I have the camera right here in front of me, and it's so hard to work with this. So I'll do this off camera. I'll be back when I'm done. But you get the idea. I'm trying to mix LECA and sphagnum moss separately in the pot. Here we are, our little community pot is done. Bonus, one of the orchids has a flower spike, so what a failed experiment. This is the one I fertilized, actually, and it didn't have anything to do with fertilizer because both of the orchids received fertilizer from the medium. But yeah, this experiment needs to start when the flowers are done. So I need to find a set of orchids which look the same and start the experiment in spring or after they're done with their flowers, and I'll use sphagnum moss because I know it's not fertilized. Anyway, I digress. So I'm really curious to see how this setup will actually do, because I want to see if the effect of moss, or actually the acidity of moss, will reduce the quantity of efflorescence. Because moss is so acidic, maybe it will actually make absorption better, so I will not have as much buildup, I don't know. Also, as I was saying, I want to see how fast the moss decomposes, how easy it is to be removed, because LECA doesn't need to be removed, but moss does. So if the LECA has enough air pockets, maybe the moss can be removed easily. I used minimum amounts of moss actually, and this is a self-watering pot, so yeah, it's a very economical organic slash inorganic slash very wet setup. We'll see how it does, and Phalaenopsis are the best ones to test this with because they have such robust root systems. They're very reliable little orchids, and at the same time we are going to see how the community pot goes. But this is how I would go about it. I personally don't intend to do much of these, it's not my thing. I prefer my orchids solo in their pot. But anyway, thank you for watching, hope you've enjoyed this. You know the drill, like or dislike this video below. Subscribe to my channel for regular orchid videos, tutorials, Q&As and other fun orchid subjects. And if you like YouTube to notify you whenever I upload a new video, just turn on notifications for my channel. Also, if you'd like to know more about my climate, environment, setup, what products I use, do expand the description, everything is there. And with that said, I'll see you guys next time. Bye!